Thank you very much, sir, for your generous comments, totally undeserved. Ladies and gentlemen, you heard about the complexity in science. The complexity of Indian culture is no less. The problem about speaking of Indian culture is that whatever you say, the opposite is equally true. So whatever I would say, please remember that the opposite would also be true. And culture is something about which everyone has a view. So your views are as good as what I'm going to say. As you know, the topic is the changing cultural paradigm. Here the problem is whether we all know, we are experiencing it, we are seeing it, that culture is changing. But whether it is a paradigm change or whether it is a process of change which has been going over centuries is something which I think we have to discuss. And I don't think I have any final questions, I mean final answers. And I doubt if anyone can say with finality that yes, it is a paradigm shift or it is not a paradigm shift. The problem here is that change in Indian culture has been going on over the millennia for various reasons. I shall not go into the history of it. For example, the introduction of law from Mesopotamia in prehistoric times would have changed the culture. And that probably would have been called a paradigm shift. The British introduced the iron plow. It used to be wooden plow earlier, which again changed the way our agriculture was done and, you know, so on. You know, the term paradigm itself, it was brought into common currency by Thomas Kuhn in 1962. It's a very recent thing. And that was in his book, The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. So it's a concept from science which has been taken over, and now we are talking of paradigm shift in social sciences, paradigm shift in this, paradigm shift in that, paradigm shift in culture. Fritjof Capra then later on adapted this term, and he said a paradigm is a constellation of concepts, values, perceptions and practices shared by a community. Now here I am quoting this because the question here is shared by a community, which forms a particular vision of reality. That is the basis of the way a community organizes itself, the vision of reality and sharing of community. Now, this is where the problem comes. What is one's vision of reality? And culture, interestingly, no Indian language has or rather had a word for culture. Sanskriti is now used. It's a neologism coined very recently in the early 20th century, or maybe 20s or so of the 20th century. Before that, we did not have a word corresponding to culture. And Sanskrit, as I said, is a recent coinage. Now, Sanskriti, if you say Indian culture, you have one kind of a vision, which is inclusive, which is Indo-Aryan, Dravidian, Aryan, Indo-Islamic, and Indo-British, and all that. But when you say it in one of our Indian languages, and you call it Bharatiya Sanskriti, the complexion changes. So when you're talking of Indian culture and changing of paradigm, it depends on which glasses are you seeing it through. Are you seeing it through the glasses of Indian languages, or are you seeing it through the English glasses? Now, the culture, the word culture itself comes from the Latin cultura, which means cultivation, growing. I mean, Cicero used it first, called it cultura d'anime, which means cultivation of the spirit, cultivation of the mind. And then it was adapted. And before you say that, well, in Indian languages it is a recent coinage, even in English it dates from the early 19th century. It's used in the sense of collective customs and achievements of a people dates from 1867 only. So we were not very far behind in coining the word Sanskriti in our languages. Except that in Tamil, Sundaram would bear me out, I looked at the dictionary, English-Tamil dictionary, and it is Kalacharam. But Kalacharam also is a coinage and is related to Kala. Apart from this, leaving aside the Nagamese and Mizo and those languages, in every Indian language, the concept is Sanskriti. Now, talking of Bharatiya Sanskriti, Sanskriti then is from the same root as Sanskara and Sanskrit. So you are giving it a certain coloring when you say Bharatiya Sanskriti. This becomes relevant in the context of the debate that is going on about saffronization, about Hindutva on the one hand, and globalization and westernization on the other. Now, Hindutva itself was a term coined by Savarkar. He is the progenitor of this concept of Hindutva. And interestingly, Savarkar himself was an atheist. He was not a Hindu in the sense that we understand. And one of his poems, he was a prolific writer in Marathi. In fact, he presided over Marathi Sahitya Sammelan twice. And in Maharashtra today, he is revered as much as an author as a freedom fighter. In fact, Rath, Professor Rath of Dandekar and Rath, poverty line fame, was talking to me and he said that he was a great admirer of his writings in Marathi on social issues. And as you know, Rath is no votary of Hindutva. He's as much on the left as can be. But Savarkar's this poem, I'm just reading one bit of it, it's like a school anthem in Maharashtra. It says, Jayos Tute, Sriman Mangale Shivaspade Shubade, Swatantrate Bhagavati Twamaham Yashoyatam Bande, Rashtrase Chaitanya Murtutum, Niti Sambadasi, Swatantrate Bhagavati Srimati Rani Tutyasi. Now, here, this is a hymn to Swatantrata, independence. And he envisions Swatantrata as a goddess, Bhagavati. But the interesting part is the connotations for a Marathi, with the words like Shivaspade and Bhagavati, would take him to Shivaji and that rule. So, here is an atheist who is envisioning the independence, the Swatantrata, as goddess Bhagavati, as Bankim Chandra in Vande Mataram envisioned India, Bharat Mata, as Durga. So you can see that the debate which is now taking place has its roots long back in our history. And I will read another stanza from a Hindi poem this time, that was Marathi. Sansar ko pehle hamine gyan shiksha daan ki. I suppose all of you understand Hindi, otherwise I'll translate it into English. Sansar ko pehle hamine gyan shiksha daan ki, achar ki, vyapar ki, vyavhar ki, vigyan ki. फैला यहीं से ज्ञान का आलोक सब संसार में जागी यहीं थी जग रही जो ज्योति अब संसार में यह पुण्य भूमि प्रसिद्ध है इसके निवासी आर्य हैं विद्या कला कौशल्य सबके जो प्रथम आचार्य हैं संसार को पहले हम ही ने ज्ञान शिक्षा दान की है. We were the first to give the light of knowledge to the world. We gave the knowledge of good conduct, of commerce and trade, of science. फैलाई इनसे ज्ञान का आलोक सब संसार में. The light of knowledge was spread in the world by India. And the light of knowledge which shined in the world originated here in India. And this is the blessed land which is famous, and the inhabitants of this land are Aryas, and they are masters of knowledge, of arts, of technology, etc. And this is what you would say is being said by the votaries of Hindutva, isn't it? And this is what one says is saffronization all about. But this poem was written in 1912 by an arch congressman, Maitri Sharan Gupt, who was a close friend of Pandit Nehru, wore khadi all his life, spun charkha, and was a member of the parliament till he died. So now, the vision of Indian culture of a staunch Congressite is this. This is where the problem comes. When you're talking of saffronization or paradigm change in of culture, now which culture are we talking about? There is one problem. We cannot develop except in relation to a religion. It's modern because it's T.S. Eliot. When Maitri Sharan Gupt says that all knowledge, everything went from India and this is the land of Aryas and Dharma, then it becomes saffronization. So there we have a problem. And I don't think there are there would be any common ground on that. Now when you say Bharatiya Sanskriti, you say that what are the pillars of Bharatiya Sanskriti? Commonly accepted could be Bharatiya Samskriti ke aadhar char hai, dharma, artha, kama and moksha. Now when you are talking of dharma, artha, kama and moksha, you take it into a different direction. Question here is, before the word Samskriti was coined, what were we using? For these concepts, probably the word used was dharma only. And dharma, as you know, comes from the root dhru, which means to hold. So that which holds together, that which sustains, that is dharma. And of course, there are various definitions of dharma according to one's philosophical and religious background. But one which I think is very interesting comes from the Jaina philosophy, which says vastu svabhava dharma. The innate nature of things is dharma. Professor Shetter is an authority on Jaina philosophy, but vastu svabhava dharma, that is the innate nature of things is dharma. That is the innate nature of fire is to burn and the innate nature of water is to cool. So dharma, which was holding together, was what we had, this concept. And dharma, by its very nature, has to be eternal. Otherwise, it's not dharma. So when we are talking of the changing paradigm, and we look at it from this angle, now, with dharma sustaining the Bharatiya Samskriti and the concept, is it a paradigm change or is it a continuing process which has been going over the millennia? Now the most celebrated tome on culture in Hindi is Ramdhari Singh Dinkar's. I'm sure those who are from Hindi belt would have known about this book, Samskriti ke Char Adhyay. He looks at Indian culture in terms of four encounters. The first between Aryans and Dravidians, second Buddhists and Jains, third is Islam and Aryans, and fourth is the British and Indian listing. You can see that this process has been continuing, but what we are seeing now is something which we feel is totally different, for the simple reason that the minute of Macaulay is now bearing some very interesting fruits. All of you are familiar with Macaulay's minute, 1835. He said a class of persons, Indian in blood and color, but English in taste, in opinions, in morals, and in intellect. So this is 1835. 1837, Persian was replaced by Urdu, which gave rise to the dispute between Hindi and Urdu, and finally Hindi was given the equal status with Urdu, and the English became dominant. And now this minute of 1835, through which English was introduced in India, has really produced a class of persons, Indian in blood and color, but English in taste, in opinions, in morals, and in intellect. The problem is that, can we do without English, or can we go back to the roots? So, if we say that globalization and westernization that we are experiencing today is the result of this minute of 1835, then this process has been going on for over 150 years or so. So this is another problem. Shripad Nayak, tomorrow we are going to have this International Yoga Day, and the minister in charge in Government of India, Shripad Nayak of Ayush. Ayush, as you know, is Ayurveda, Yunani, Siddha, and homeopathic systems. So he has been made the minister in charge for this Yoga International Day. Just 3-4 days ago, you might have read in the Times of India or one of these papers his statement. He said it was time to clear away the vestiges of Western lifestyle left behind by colonial powers. So on the one hand, you have this feeling at the subterranean level saying that we must do away with the vestiges of Western lifestyle and influence left behind by colonial powers, and English is probably the strongest of those influences. And on the other hand, you have the modern science and technology about which you just have heard and you have been hearing since morning, which is taking us in a different direction. So what do we say about it? Now, Benjamin Barber, in a paper which is quite interesting, some of you might have come across that paper, Jihad versus Macworld. Now, Jihad is, in his view, an inward-looking, religion-based culture which is looking back at the past. And Macworld is the globalized world with all the benefits of technology, etc. For example, Economist magazine came out with this concept of Macburger parity. The economists here might have read about that. So, which side are we going to take? Is it going to be an inward-looking jihad kind of thing, or we are going into the back world? On the face of it, we are going into the back world. But then again, as I said, the complexity of Indian culture is no less than the complexity of science. What does this back world have to do for or say to 60% of Indians who are living below the poverty line? What cultural changes are we talking about when we talk about that? Now, we have various polarities in India. From the beginning, we had the Dravidian and Aryan polarity, we had the village and town polarity, we had Hindu and Muslim, and so on. You name the polarity and it is there in our culture. Now, town and village, the whole Gandhian philosophy was based on the village. Whereas Ambedkar said, what is a village? a sink of localism, a den of ignorance, narrow-mindedness and communalism. So we are unable to reconcile even these two views of Gandhi and Ambedkar as far as the culture is concerned. Now, my point is that the first half of the 20th century was dominated by Gandhian thinking in culture as well as politics or whatever. The second by Ambedkar. To my mind, the view forward in the 21st century, the way forward is to be found in Tagore. I am a great admirer of Tagore, and I think he shows the way. Now, Tagore said that he was a product of a confluence of three cultures, Hindu, Mohammedan, and British. And Satyajit Ray called himself a combined product of East and West. All of us sitting here are combined products of East and West. So, are we talking of a cultural paradigm shift or change when we ourselves are products of mixed cultures? As I said, I have no final answers and I don't think anyone can have any answers. What is now happening is that thanks to the development of technology, it was the introduction of plow in one age and it is information superhighway in the present age, which is bringing about interconnectedness, interconnected with the wider world, in the real world as well as the virtual world. How is it going to impact our economy and our culture? We don't know. I mean, these are all questions about which there can be no finality. Are we going to be world citizens? I think for quite some time there are two streams. One, which we have given the name of Hindutva and saffronization, and the other as globalization or so, would probably go on colliding and then maybe something new would come out of it as the collision of Hindu and Muslim cultures gave rise to Urdu, which I think is one of the finest cultural constructs of our country because it has given us the great poetry of Nazir Akbar Abadi and Ghalib and Mir Taqi Mir and others. And incidentally, the birthplace of Urdu literature is Karnataka. But this is Bijapur. The first writings were done in Bijapur and Gulbarga. Interestingly, in Karnataka, when you hear the Nadagite, which is the state anthem of Karnataka, there is no mention of the achievements of Bahmanis or of Urdu or whatever. So, what is the other? Here the other has been the Islamic culture, the Muslims. Gujarat is called the laboratory of Hindutva. But again, the complexity and the ironies of Indian culture and paradoxes. I read Gujarati papers and I was subscribing to a magazine, Gujarati magazine, and I found their fascination with Muslim culture and Urdu was probably stronger than anywhere else I have seen. In fact, today, one of the finest Urdu poets Gujarat, I mean, one of the finest Urdu poets is a Gujarati, and Parmar, and he writes in Urdu. He learned Urdu and is one of the foremost giant Parmar, not a Muslim, a Gujarati whose mother tongue is not Urdu. So, which is going to be the other in this? So, maybe, as I said, the way forward is what Tagore said. He said, Hethai Archo, Hetha Anarcho, Hethai Dravido Chin, Shokhun Dol Pathan Mughal, Eko Dehe Hololin, Poshchimaji Khulia Chedar, Shethavot Shobeyane Upohar, Dibeya Nibe, Minabe Miline Jabena Phire, এই ভারতের মহামানবের তীরে, আই হোপ মাই প্রোনাউন্সিয়েশন ইজ অল রাইট, ইফ ইউ আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড, বাট সো হি সেজ দ্যাট হিয়ার দি এরিয়ানস, দি নন এরিয়ানস, দি দ্রাবিডিয়ানস, দি মঙ্গোলাইট, দি পশ্চিম, ইটস রেফারিং টু দোজ শাক্স, হুনস, পাঠানস, মুঘলস, এক দেহে হলো নিন, দে বিকাম মার্জড ইন ওয়ান বডি, অ্যান্ড নাও দি ডোর অফ ওয়েস্ট হ্যাজ ওপেন, পশ্চিম আজই খুলিয়াছে দ্বার, নাও দি ডোর অফ ওয়েস্ট হ্যাজ ওপেন, সেটা হচ্ছে সবে আনে উপহার, অ্যান্ড পিপল আর ব্রিংকিং গিফটস ফ্রম দ্যাট, সো ইউ ক্যান লুক অ্যাট ইট দিস ওয়ে, দ্যাট দি ডোর অফ ওয়েস্ট হ্যাজ ওপেন, and gifts are being brought from there, and whatever we have by way of science, technology, information technology, whatever changes are going to take place, whether it's a paradigm change in culture or whether it is an ongoing process like that of a coral reef where it sort of grows over a period of time. Incidentally, this image comes from a book, Bharatiya Samskriti, by Preetimati Goyal. This book won an award by the Sanskrit Academy of Rajasthan government. So she gives this metaphor of coral reef for Indian culture. But interestingly, in the entire book which won an award, there is no mention of the South except for a few stray references here and there. Whereas Bharatiya could write a poem on Guru Gobind Singh and also on Himalaya and on northern this thing, but then those are this part of the complexity we are talking about. And as I said, there are no final answers to this conundrum, whether we are seeing a paradigm change in culture or whether we are seeing the continuum of the change which has occurred in Indian culture over the millennia. And again, hethai archo, hetha anarcho, Aryas, non-Aryas, Anaryas, hethai dravid chin, shok hoon dal pathan mughal ek dehe holo leen. Thank you very much.
Say I am Dravida's Shishu, it did not mean what it means now, the divide, the so-called divide which Max Müller tried to portray in his invasion theory, which became a migration theory, which has now been disproved by the Human Genome Project of the UN. The early man came out of Africa and out of India they migrated, so now it's the out of India theory. But we have lived all along with this because of the 1836 template put on us. The worldview is Western, the lens is Western, the attitude is Western, the taste is Western, the language is Western, our paradigms are Western. We just can't think beyond that because we are, I want to comment on it, these are not my opinions. So we are so dyed in the wool that there is nothing we can see beyond what we have been totally immersed in since 1836. And there is nothing, and our natural genius in India, India's chosen disorder, not because it's deliberate, it's because we have lost our natural genius, because we think in an alien template, culture, viewpoint, worldview, attitude, tastes, lifestyle, everything. If only we got rid of that, this is a particular view, not mine, we would come back to our natural genius and progress much more. Israel in 1947 did not have Hebrew as its language there. It developed Hebrew after 1947, now it's a full-fledged scientific language in Israel. You can do your PhD in Hebrew, in science. But in India, we're still sticking on to that. So you comment on that.
You see, I said in the beginning that it depends on how you through which spectacles you see. You see them through the English spectacles, or I'd say now Western spectacles, or you see them through the Indian language spectacles. As far as Dravidian and Aryan is concerned, it's again part of the complexity of Indian cultural scene. And there can be no finality about this, because earlier the word Dravid has been used. Yeah. So Dravid is then taken as the original term of Dravid. And the migration, I mean, now as you say, from Africa, everybody moved on to different parts of the world. Linguistically also, I mean, this is now accepted that Dravidians came from Mediterranean side, because one of the Dravidian languages, Brahui, is there in Balochistan. So this is a remnant. And the Pakistani, some of the scholars are at pains to prove that Punjabi is a Dravidian language. They seize on words like Chati and some other words and say, though on this side of the divide, we say Punjabi is the first born of the Vedic language. Now, my native village was just about 10 miles from Harappa. So I don't know what genes I carry of that civilization. So whether I am a Dravidian or Aryan, I do not know what mixture I have. This controversy is not going to be solved. As far as going back to Hebrew in Israel is concerned, it was a historic moment, and the history of Jews probably made it simpler. There was a debate after independence whether Sanskrit should be made the national language. Had it been made the national language, now in this talk about Samskriti. I mentioned that Samskriti is from the same root as Sanskara and Sanskrit. Now Sanskaras, Dvijas undergo Samskaras. 40% of the Indian population would have been left out, or is left out when you use the term Sanskriti. Maybe we need to coin a different word for culture now, as has been done in Pakistani Punjabi. They have coined the word Rehtar, which means the way we live. So, if you say that Sanskrit, we go back to Sanskrit like Hebrew, first you leave out 40% of the population. Secondly, this question of Dravidian and Aryan will stare you in the face. So, Nodi Swami na hero de hiye as the same Kannada. ठीक है जैसा चलते हैं चलने लीजिए.
You quoted to Sharma's poem composed in 1902. Those were the days, you see, when there were compulsions to exaggerate and lie because of the freedom movement and other kinds of compulsions. Even Tilak did, and he died. He lied consciously, although he was a great scholar. In Sharma's poetry, everything is wrong. That everything went from India is wrong, and Aryans are, that is also wrong. Everything is wrong, but you see, it was endearing in the sense that people wanted them to be proud of our culture first. So it was tolerated. Why I mention this one is, if you see the elements of saffronization in that, which is unconsciously there, and the elements of saffronization that you see, or there is a ocean of difference. I want you to comment.
You see, Maitri Sharan Gupta's poem is from, it's a part of a longer work called Bharat Bharati, which was published in 1912. So the poem probably would be from 1910 or so, anyway, more than 100 years old. What I was trying to say is that when you're talking of paradigm shift, it's a sudden change. Like when origin of the species came, it was a paradigm change. Whereas even when you are talking of saffronization and Hindutva, It's a process which has been going on for a very long time. And Maitri Sharan Gupta's Bharat Bharati is a representative of that. Now, I do not think that there is a world of difference between the saffronization ideas of today and what Maitri Sharan Gupta was saying there. The context has changed. But then remember that Sripad Nayak is saying, the minister is saying, that we must get rid of vestiges of colonialism. You see, the Yoga Day, which is going to be celebrated tomorrow, this idea was given by Dr. Nagendra. I don't know whether you must be knowing him. Dr. Nagendra is an engineer who was a scientist, I mean, who was an engineer with NASA. And he has set up this S. Vyasa University here in Bangalore, which has produced, it's a recognized university now, it has produced about 103 PhD students and all. If you go there, their lab is state of the art. The molecular lab, in fact, is being manned by someone who was trained at the Max Planck Institute. And you see it written there that combining ancient wisdom of India with latest technology. This is their motto. So, if you say that there is a world of difference between what is now being denoted by saffronization and what was said by Maitri Sharan Gupta in Bharat Bharati, I don't think there is a world of difference. It's a subterranean continuous thing. Even Bankim Chandra, or even before that, look at the other, for example, in Sharad Chandra's novels, there are no Muslim characters. Even in Rabindranath Tagore, except for Ghare Paire, Ananda will bear me out. Rabindranath Tagore, in his works, you don't find Muslim characters. You have in Premchand...
Kabuliwala.
Pardon?
Kabuliwala.
Kabuliwala is, yes, but it's a... I mean, that's... It's not in the novels. Yeah. Premchand, for example, who represents what is called the Ganga Jamuni Tehsil, because Kayas were called the Hindu Muslims. Kayas were the first among the Hindus who took to Persian and became office holders under the Mughals. So naturally, and they had their own script Kathi, which has now been superseded by Devanagari. And therefore, in Premchand you have Muslim characters, in his novels also. It has been going on. This process, what we have given the name saffronization, is it because those of us who are enjoying the benefits of an elitist education through English and all, feel a bit threatened by the rise of people who challenge this? I don't know. But there is no world of difference in my view.
Thank you, sir, for your very insightful and provocative and I think very thought-provoking speech. You made some very relevant and important points. And I agree with a lot of the issues you raised. Also, I think this idea of the genetics, there's still a lot of debate on that. So I think that's... I agree with you there. What I was wanting to point out is that when we look at these two, the two sides of it, you talked about globalization on the one side and the other side, the aspect of identity, which is manifesting in different ways, whether you call it, also sort of bolstered by political, aspirations and such, like on the one hand Hindutva, but we also see it, let's say, in the Islamic world and things like that, the sort of identity in relation to religion, all that. But actually, in a way, it's really thanks to the fact that we have access to so much of technology and this and that, that all of these identity issues have actually sharpened over time, because probably when you look at India maybe some centuries ago and things like that, but there wasn't that kind of availability of technology to be able to spread these kind of sentiments across a large number of people. It you know, you still had groups of communities, whether it was your Virulas or your Kotas or your Barakas and so on, various communities living in coexistence and such like. And you also see that very much in the Islamic world, that, you know, you had so many Sufi practices and so on, but then so much of the Wahhabi Islam has been, you know, transmitted in a much, so that has given rise to much more radical forms of the, those religious practices or whatever. And that's also what's happening perhaps with ideas of, you know, sort of some of the more, let's say, extremist notions also in India. So in a way, how do we